Welcome to the eAcademy. In this episode, we will focus on the INT-TSH2 keypad, and specifically, we will look at its interface. Let me add that this keypad is equipped with a 7-inch touchscreen. There is also the INT-TSG2 model, which is smaller, has a 4.3-inch screen, but offers the same interface. Both keypads can operate with the Integra, Integra Plus, or Versa control panels families. For more information on these keypads, their capabilities and technical parameters, please click on the link below this video. So let's move on to discuss the INT-TSH2 keypad interface. We can distinguish three levels of menu: upper, middle, and bottom. What does it look like and how does it work in practice? It is best to explain with examples, so let's look at the keypad. Our INT-TSH2 keypad has already been connected to the Integra 128 Plus control panel and successfully identified. It currently has only factory settings loaded. The first screen we see is the screensaver. By default, it shows the clock and date. A number of other widgets can also be placed on the screensaver. These include status indicators for partitions, zones, outputs, or temperature readings. We will tell you how to configure the keypad in the next episode. Please take a look. At the top of the INT-TSH2 keypad screen, you can see four basic icons indicating the system status. In the case of the smaller model, INT-TSG2, these are represented by the LED backlit pictograms located above the display. The menu level on which the screensaver is located is called upper level. In the keypad, which features a mounted SD card with stored photos, you can switch from the screensaver to the photo frame by dragging your finger from right to left. In our case, nothing like that happens because, as we mentioned before, this unit has only the factory settings loaded. There is also no memory card installed with photos that could be displayed, so the slideshow is not available. From the screensaver, we can always switch to a lower, middle level. To do this, we simply touch the screen anywhere. To return, we drag our finger down the screen. You can also move to the middle level by dragging your finger upwards on the screen. Let's look at our diagram. The middle level consists of user screens. Just like on the screensaver, various types of widgets can be placed on these screens. In addition to system status indicators, we can have here switches or icons that can be used to trigger macro commands. Our screen consists of icons for the macro commands used to arm the system in various modes or to disarm it. In addition, there are also three icons used to trigger panic, fire, and medical alarms. Next to them, the information widget icon is visible. When it is clicked, a window with the previously entered text is displayed. As you can see, by default, there are only three dots here. When the keypad is configured, you can enter your own text there, for example, information about the installer who services the system or the date where the installation should be checked. We can see that it is currently not possible to move to the right or left from this screen. Why? Because we currently have no other user screens available. Please look at the bottom of the display. Here you can find an indicator showing the number of screens. A single dot means that our project has only one user screen available in the middle menu level. Okay, let's have one more look at the diagram showing the structure of the interface menu. As I have already mentioned, we can have several, well, maximum 8 actually, user screens. Let's look at the right part of the diagram. In addition to the 8 user screens, 16 additional screens can be created. To move between them and the user screens, you will need to click on a special widget, a so-called link. We will show how the link works in a minute by using a keypad with a more complex menu design uploaded. From the middle level of the menu, we can go to the last bottom level, that is, to the user menu containing the functions of the control panel. Only a logged-in user has access to this level. A user who has been logged in can switch between the middle and lower levels without having to re-enter the password. Okay, let's go back to the keypad. To move to the bottom level, we drag our finger from the bottom of the screen upwards. The on-screen keyboard appears. We use the administrator password. Confirm. To go back up a level, drag your finger across the screen from top to bottom. You can also access the user menu using the icon shown in the top right corner. Next to it, you can read that you are logged in as the administrator. You do not need to re-enter your password. We select Menu. We will now take a look at what the various functions of the user menu look like. Let's check the partitions. Here you can see a list of the partitions with an indication of their status. From the bottom of the screen, you can pull out buttons that are used to change the list view. To return to the main menu, you can tap the arrow in the upper right corner or drag your finger from the left edge of the screen. You can navigate through the other functions in a similar way. To return to the user screens, you can press the arrow at the top right of the screen or drag your finger across the screen from top to bottom. Now, for a change, we log out the administrator and log in with the service password. As you can see, the service menu looks similar to the user menu. Click Others, select Service Mode. We can see that the service mode menu looks completely different than the one known from the keypads available so far. Navigating such a menu is easy and intuitive. Have a look. Let's go through it one by one. Structure, Hardware, LCD keypads, Settings. We select our keypad marked as INT-TSH2. You can see exactly the path we took to get to the place that we are now. To go back one by one to higher levels of the service mode menu, we touch the arrow button in the upper right corner of the screen. As before, you can also go back by dragging your finger from the left edge of the screen. Continue until you return to the main service mode menu. Important note, for those who prefer legacy solutions or are used to traditional LCD keypads, a terminal mode is also available. To activate it, click the keypad icon in the upper right corner of the screen. So let's go to the keypad settings for a while. Okay, return and exit the terminal mode. Exit the service mode. Okay, we have seen the menu structure of the INT-TSH2 keypad interface using the factory settings as an example. Now we will show you what the interface menu may look like in the configured keypad. The screensaver looks different. The first thing that strikes the eye is the different color theme used. In addition to the clock and date, we see the status of the gate and garage door. The temperature measured inside and outside the building is also displayed. From the screensaver, we move to the right to the photo frame function. The slideshow can also be stopped at any moment. Now let's move to the middle level of the menu, the user screens. The first one we open, which is our main screen, contains the same elements as the one available with the factory settings. However, when you click on the information icon, the system installer contact details are displayed. And here is the thing we mentioned a little earlier. Several dots can be seen at the bottom of the screen. Their number indicates how many user screens are available in the project. In our case, there are 4 dots, so at this level, we have 4 screens. In addition, a filled dot indicates which screen we are currently on. Very well. Since there is only one screen on the left, we go straight to it. Here you can see a map of our exemplary facility with the statuses of zones and partitions. On the left, there are buttons for independent arming and disarming each of them. Now we move to the right to a screen used for controlling groups of home automation devices. Each button is a link to an additional screen. Select Lighting. From here, you can control selected lights or groups of them. We go back and select rollers. From this screen, you can raise or lower the roller blinds in individual rooms or throughout the house. Now let's move to the gates. Here we can open or close the main gate, garage gate, or wicket. You can also control lighting at the entrance to the property and the garage driveway. Now, heating and air condition. First, we select heating. The building plan shows where heating is turned on and what the temperature is in each room and outside the building. The heating can be switched on or off independently in each room. It's the same with air condition. Now we go back. From this screen, we can turn on or off the entire heating or air condition group. So we click Heating, All Off. As you can see, all the indicators corresponding to the heaters have changed their status to Off. Now, the sprinklers. The property plan shows which sprinklers are currently on and which are not working. We can also turn them on or off separately. We come to the last screen. From here, you can control the functions of the system in selected rooms or parts of the property. So we click on the icon for the living room. For example, we can switch on one of the lamps. It is also possible to activate the entire scene. We can see that individual elements of the system have changed their status. We return to the previous screen. I will now select Garden. Here you can also quickly control selected automation elements. We return to the user screens to go lower and finally enter the settings menu. Okay, we see that the menu of the control panel functions looks the same as we presented it earlier. It differs only in the color theme. Okay, that's all for now. Next time we'll show you how to configure the keypad so that you can prepare a menu design project similar to the one just shown. Thank you and feel welcome to the next eAcademy episodes. See you!